Hi guys, welcome. Today, we are going to be talking about art again. You know, a few weeks, most of you were down here to look at the beginning of art, cave art. Today, we are going to look at a very important time period, and that time period is basically the Classical Age, Greek and Roman art. What we're going to be looking at is the importance of this art when we look at ourselves. One of the reasons why we do this is so that we can understand the connections between the past and the world in which we live today. And the Greek and Roman world is still all around us. It's the Greeks and the Romans who established what we call Western culture. And that Western culture is what we are. So we're going to be looking at the past. We're also going to be looking at manifestations of the past in the world around us today. Now, everywhere around us, there are connections to the past, which is one of the reasons why we do these art forms. In order to understand the world around us, we have to understand where all this stuff came from. So that when we watch something like The Simpsons, for example, we know what they're talking about.
Mom, I'd like you to meet your new co-worker, Mindy Simmons. I think she has a degree in engineering or something.
Hi, how's it going?
Oh, pleased to meet you.
Yeah, ditto.
Hi.
Mama, what's the matter?
Ain't you never seen a naked chick riding a clam before?
Now, that naked chick riding a clam, the writers of The Simpsons hope you recognize that image. If not recognize the image by name, at least find it somewhat familiar. Because this image, although it's not ancient Greek, it's part of our Western culture. It's a 500-year-old image. And that image, of course, is called The Birth of Venus by an artist named Botticelli. And so The Simpsons want you to watch that and say, I know that image. But if you don't know the history, you don't know the image, that whole idea of a naked chick riding a clam is not funny. It's not funny because you're not making the reference. And that's really what it's all about. Trying to understand how the past affects us today. You go to certain places in the world, and certain places in the country, you're going to see references to art. Now this looks like, I mean, we got people wearing togas, it looks like. You know, we think that, hey, this is probably, you know, Greece or Europe or something. It's not. It's right outside of our capital in Washington, D.C. And so we consciously, when this country was created, we consciously began modeling ourselves after the ancient world to make that connection. We are consciously always stating we are part of that culture. And so that's what we're going to look at. Now, this is going to be really hard. We're going to be looking at probably 1,500 years of history. That's a lot of history. It's going to start in the little Greek city-states, then it's going to spread through Alexander the Great, and then all of the Roman world. That's a lot of history to talk about. And I only have about 35 minutes left, 40 minutes left. It's going to be hard to do, so I'm going to need some help. It's okay to ask for help, actually. There's been a lot of famous people that have asked for help. Gilgamesh, the first superhero in the world, he was a Mesopotamian god. He had a companion sent down by the gods named Enkidu. And these two guys then did amazing deeds as a duo. First superhero, the oldest known story in human history is Gilgamesh. And then of course we have Batman and Robin. Batman had help with the Boy Wonder, Robin. And even Dr. Evil had help. Dr. Evil had Mini-Me. Now I don't unfortunately have a Mini-Me. I wish I did, but I have something better. Since we're going to be talking a lot about statues, I brought with me today Statue Me.
Hi. Today we're going to be looking at art from four different eras. The thing about art is this. Art reflects history. So you can learn about what people thought and believed by looking at their art. For example, I am a statue from the Archaic Age. Nice, huh? and he's from the Hellenic Age. Oh, over there, Hellenistic. And, And this big guy's from the Roman Empire. We'll be looking at each of these four ages individually. See you soon.
So Statue Me is going to come around to tell us a little bit about these ages of art. We've got four ages of art to go through. And those four ages of art are divided in a chart on your sheet. It begins with the Archaic Age, that's very early Greek history. Then it goes to the Hellenic Age. Hellenic means Greek. This is Greek history as we think about it. Hellenistic, that's the age of Alexander the Great. You know, and then the Roman period that came next. And each of these ages of art have continuity, things that remain the same, but it also has some changes. So we're going to be looking at the changes in continuity in this art over time. And we have to start right there at the beginning of the Greek world. And that is a period of time known as the Archaic period. It began about 800 BCE. Now, most of the stuff is written there for you. There's just some blanks you need to fill out. But for the most part, this is really where it all began. This is the beginning of these city-states. It's the age of the Trojan War and the beginning of Greek myth, mythology, the Odyssey and the Iliad written during this time. It is when the small city-state of Athens is beginning to practice and try out something called democracy. And everywhere you look, you're going to see statues like this. In fact, if you were wealthy at the time, you would have a statue like this in your house. You would proudly display it. If you were really wealthy, the route leading up to your front door may be lined with carved statues of naked dudes. Because that's what this age is all about. It's about naked dudes. All right, now, here's where the little disclaimer comes in. I just have to tell you this. In the ancient world, they had no problems at all with nudity, especially male nudity. In fact, everything was measured by, you know, maleness. And so naked male bodies are what was everywhere. So, I just have to say, if you were at all offended by the penis, look away. You don't need to look. We're going to be seeing a lot of them. I hope it doesn't. We could call this Penis Fest 2015, really, when you get down to it, because this is what the ancient Greek world is all about. But things are going to change. That is for sure. These statues have a name. And here is Statue Me to talk about it.
I am typical of archaic art. Large carved statue of a naked guy. This type of statue was called a kuros. Notice that I am straight and balanced. My hips and shoulders are perfectly aligned. Wide shoulders, smaller waist. Perfectly symmetrical. This was much like the statues found in ancient Egypt, which tells us that the people of the Archaic Age had contact, probably through trade, with that other civilization. The female version is called the quarry. Notice that she has clothes. It wasn't acceptable at the time to show women naked. But look at her smile. This slight smile was known as the archaic smile. And this type of smile would reappear later in one of the world's most famous pieces of art, the Mona Lisa.
When we talk about the Renaissance, we're going to do a forum that focuses a lot on the Mona Lisa. That smile that everyone talks about with the Mona Lisa actually goes back to the Archaic Age. But most of the statues back then were not women. They were men. Kuros is a Greek word that means basically young warrior. And that's what they were called in the Iliad. And so naked males were the ideal. That's the standard of beauty. Beauty was measured by maleness, and naked maleness in particular. And so, you know, the Greeks used that to show the potential of man. And they're going to change it around a little bit. The thing about the Kuros statues that you're going to see is that they stand up really straight. You know, sometimes one foot is in front of the other, but they're Their hands are often clenched and they're standing up straight like this, like they've got poles shoved up their butt or like this. Now, the Greeks are going to realize that people don't stand like this, or if they do, it's not cool. I mean, you guys don't do this. I know homecoming is coming up, right? The guys, you're not going up to a lady standing by her locker going, "Hi. Homecoming is coming up. Wondering." No, you're doing this. Hey. All right. Hey, how you doing? Homecoming's next week. Yeah, you're moving your hips a little bit. Homecoming's next week, and I was just wondering, you know, if you are going to somebody. This, the way you stand when you talk, when you do things, was invented in Greece in the next age of art, as we're going to see, because things are going to change. The statues are going to change just a little bit. This is the Hellenic Age. This is the period of Greece when we think about Greece. This is what it's all about. And you'll notice this guy doesn't have arms because they fell off because it's an old statue. But it's still naked dudes. These dudes are a little bit more muscular, right? Not everybody in ancient Greece is walking around with, you know, a six-pack and, you know, pecs and everything else. It is in the ancient Greek world that they invented the supermodel, when the first supermodels were men. And they invented a particular way to stand. And that's one of the things you may notice, that they're not standing up straight anymore. They're relaxed. Yeah, they're a little balanced like this. That's something invented by the Greeks, and we still do it. And there's a name for it, as you're going to see. So this is all about Athens, right? This is the high point of Greek culture, is the Hellenic Age. Hellenic means Greek. And this is where Athens, the democracy, is flourishing. In Athens, they are doing plays. They are inventing geometry. And in fact, geometry is going to be an important thing for all of the art that is created during this period of time. They're doing philosophy. They're inventing history. They're doing all of this stuff. And their sculpture, their art, is going to glorify the male body. They're not going to depict males like they are. Like, you'll never see a statue in the ancient Greek world that looks like me, with my gut hanging over my belly. They're not going to show that. They're going to show the idealized body. It's the Greeks that invented Photoshop, really, in an age before Photoshop. They are taking what is in reality and making it look better. They're creating an ideal, and for them, the ideal was the male form. In fact, the male form was what everyone strove for, not the female form. You know, females had a really low status in ancient Greece. So females really, in ancient Athens, weren't allowed to leave the house. All right? They weren't allowed to go to plays and things like that. But in the ancient Greek world, it was all about the men. The more muscular, the more athletic, the better. It's in the ancient Greek world that they invented the Olympics. And the early Olympics were all done by athletes who were naked. Running, jumping. Everything flip-flopping around, they didn't care. You know, it was all about showing the body. All right? Here is a word that you need to know. And I'm sure you can all read that word. Yeah. This is a Greek word called sophrosyne. This word, more than any other word, this word really gets to the heart of what the Greek world was about. And it's embodied in all Greek philosophy, Greek architecture, Greek thought. Sophrosyne is the idea of balance, of harmony. It's the Greek world that made this concept of harmony in music. Because they saw all around them that there must be some balance. Symmetry is very important to the ancient Greek world. And this word represents all of this art. It's an important word to know, especially if you're going to do some writing, you know, at home, when your parents ask you, or you're talking to your parents, say, "You know what, I'm feeling a little bit out of sophrosyne." They'll be like, "What?" You say sophrosyne. That's an ancient Greek term meaning balance. And your parents are going to be so proud of you that you use the word like sophrosyne, they may give you money. That's what happened in my house. It didn't happen to me. So what does this mean for us? It means we get statues like this. This is my favorite one. This is a statue called the Discus Thrower. And Statue Me is going to talk about it.
Look at me. Am I a stud or what? This statue of Zeus or Poseidon represents the glorified male form found in Hellenic art. In fact, Greek artist Polycletus came up with a mathematical way to depict the ideal proportions for the perfect human body. And consequently, he invented the first supermodel. Yep, the first supermodels were men, naked men. And notice something else. There is a weight shift, a bent leg, a shift in the shoulder and hip axis, and a curve in the spine. This is a relaxed look that will be the standard of beauty well into the future. This is called contrapposto, and is a reflection of the Greek idea of balance called sophrosyne. Sophrosyne can be further seen in the Discus Thrower. Notice something here? Check this out. Perfect circles representing perfect symmetry. Pretty cool, huh?
Now, that statue is really something. The underlying form are circles, and that's that idea of sophrosyne. And that sophrosyne is represented in the way that they stand, and that's something called contrapposto. Contrapposto began in the ancient Greek world, and it's still with us today. This is an ancient Greek statue, contrapposto, standing with a bent hip, leg out, shifted shoulders. This is a statue 500 plus years later. Right? This is the Renaissance. This is Michelangelo. And all you got to do is pick up a magazine, all you got to do is watch TV, and you're going to see people today in various stages of contrapposto. You're not going to see people standing up straight, because the Greeks told us that that is not aesthetically pleasing. That is not pleasing to the eyes. It's not beautiful. The Greeks taught us that this is. So if you watch an award show where there's a red carpet, for example, you're going to see people on that red carpet standing in contrapposto style. Jennifer Lawrence, David Beckham. No one told David Beckham, hey, David, don't stand like you got to pull up your butt, right? It doesn't look good. David just automatically does it, and he does it, he's like, hey, I'm hot and I know it. Just look at me. And everybody does this. You do it. No one told you that that's contrapposto. No one told you that that looks better. No one had to correct the way that you stand. Because it's all around us, and it's been that way for 2,500 years. That's the importance of this. This is something that has continued. Everyone gets the message just by looking, except her. I don't know what's going on there. It's like Miley's walking the red carpet. Yeah. But Miley knows, she's just being outrageous, and she could do contrapposto as well when she wants. So when you look at the modeling world, the actors, the actresses, the red carpets, the musical stars out there, they're all Greek statues. All of them, when they stand there, they're Greek statues. Because that's what our culture tells us is good looking, and that's the legacy of the Greeks. It's been with us for a very, very long time, and it hasn't gone away. That's one of the long-lasting contributions of the ancient world. But things are going to change. Whew, boy, are they ever. They're going to change when the Greeks lose the Peloponnesian War. And I say the Greeks lost. It was really Athens and her allies who lost. Athens lost the Peloponnesian Wars. They watched their boats, their entire navy, be destroyed. But everybody lost in the Greek world, because 27-year war left the Greek world divided and weak. And that allowed them to be taken over for the first time. For the first time, Macedonia in the north swooped down, took over Greece, and eventually Alexander the Great conquered the rest of Greece and then conquered the known world. Everything was out of balance. Sophrosyne was gone. The Greeks didn't know what to do. Athens struggled to figure out why they lost. They believed that they were the greatest. And so the art began to change, and what we get is the Hellenistic Age. Istic means like. It's the Greek-like age. So Alexander the Great loved Greeks. And so when he conquered Persia, he spread Greek culture. But that Greek culture now had shifted. No longer was it about just naked men. Now there's equal opportunity nudity. For the first time in history, you get women in the Western world depicted without clothing. But you also get something else. You get something else you never would have seen in the Hellenic age. And that something else is drama in art. It's realism in art. Like this old woman. Never would you see in the golden age of Greece, in the Hellenic age, would anyone ever consider making a statue that shows an old woman with bent back doing back-breaking labor. That's not sophrosity. That's not what the Greeks were all about. But now they are. Why? Because the Greek world had shifted. Things are out of balance. They're going to show things as they are sometimes, not as they want it to be. They're going to show more emotion. They're going to show more drama. Like this. This is carved out of a solid piece of marble. And it shows, it's a mythical story, this guy here. He's just ultra muscular. He's a big guy, so they're still, got that going for them. But he's in a life and death struggle with a snake that's about to bite his head. All right? The Greek world was now taken over. Violence, destruction, rise of empires is going to cause a shift in the way the Greeks approach life, in the way they approach art. More realism, more drama, more emotion is now being placed into art.
Look at me now. I am Venus de Milo of the Hellenistic age. For the first time in Western art, we get the female nude. Notice the contrapposto? That's not going to go away anytime soon. But the Hellenistic age did see some major changes. There's a certain realism found in Hellenistic art. Art that depicts things as they are, not as they wanted it to be. Also, the art tended to be dramatic. And emotional, such as in this one, the dying Gaul.
So more emotion, more drama, violence, that's going to be a part of the Hellenistic world. Now, the Hellenistic world is not going to last that long. After Alexander dies, his kingdom is broken up. And then a new empire is going to rise, and that new empire is the last one. That's the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire is going to start off much like ancient Athens. It's going to be a city-state that's going to develop a type of democracy called a representative democracy, which is a republic. And then they're going to start taking territory and land and starting to conquer all over, till eventually they're going to take over the entire Mediterranean Sea. They're going to call it Mare Nostrum, our sea. And they're going to create a huge empire. And from that empire, we're going to get law from the Romans. We're going to get language. The Latin language is going to be a root of a lot of our language. And we're going to get these buildings and these ideas about power, these ideas about glory from Rome. They were highly influenced by the Greeks. In fact, the Romans borrowed everything from the Greeks, and they acknowledged it. They took Greek gods and they made them Roman. They took Greek stories, like the Iliad, and changed it to a Roman story. For example, Aphrodite is the Greek goddess of love. They changed her name to Venus. And so it's the same goddess, does the same things for the most part, but now they have different names. But the art is going to take on a different purpose. The Greeks were showing art to reflect beauty and balance. The Romans are going to use it for propaganda. Propaganda means using art to make people think differently about something. And for the Romans, it was all about showing how great Romans are. The Romans used art to show the power of the empire, the power of the emperor, and to show that you just don't mess with Rome. If you do, you're dead. Because Rome, that's what they did. They conquered. And they displayed their ability to conquer and their ability to make war and to destroy. They embodied that in their art. And their art became a message to the world. Don't mess with us. We are the greatest. So everything was bigger. Everything was better for the Romans. The Romans are not known so much for their art, per se. Their sculptures look very much like Greek sculptures, except they put their guys in uniform, especially if we're talking about generals or emperors. It's their buildings that live on, because their buildings are going to reflect those same ideas. They're going to start with what the Greeks did.
If you ever stumble upon a statue of some guy on a horse in the middle of a small town, thank the Romans. This is a statue of Marcus Aurelius made in the year 165. The Romans loved art that elevated ideas of the state and civic responsibility. This can be seen most, not in statues like these, but monuments like this. The Column of Trajan, made in 113. It includes a relief sculpture 650 feet long, showing mass slaughter and over 150 scenes. The Romans made things on a massive scale. They may have copied much of what the Greeks did, but did it bigger, much bigger.
The contribution that the Romans are going to give us is in their buildings, for the most part. The Romans used building to show their power, to show their greatness. Like this building here. If you turn over your sheet, you'll see a picture like this. Now, this is something you should recognize as to what this is. What is this? It's what? It's not a bridge. It's kind of a bridge, but not a bridge for people. It's a bridge for water. It's an aqueduct. The aqueducts the Romans used, and these stretched for sometimes thousands of miles, crisscrossing Europe, to bring water down from the mountains so they could have fresh water and they could run fountains. They realized that if water is coming down from a mountain and it goes down about an inch every mile, it'll produce enough gravity and enough pressure to run fountains. So that's what they did. They took this idea that they perfected, the idea of the arch, and used it for something practical. But the arch is going to be more than just something practical. The Romans are going to realize that the arch is an engineering feat. It's a way to distribute weight, so you don't have to use as much building material. They could have built this in any way they wanted. But they wanted to take that Greek idea of sophrosyne, of balance and symmetry, and use it to produce this. And you know, a lot of these are still standing throughout the world. The three things that we're going to be looking at from the Greek and Roman world are the column, the arch, and the dome. Architecture is a form of art, and we have some pictures down there on your sheet to represent this. And it really starts with this building. This is the ancient Greek world. This is the Hellenic age right here. And this is the Parthenon. The Parthenon, of course, is in ancient Athens. It has columns. It has a post and lintel construction. That is, there is a flat piece of, like a cornerstone there, going across the top of the lintel, and you got, a triangular-shaped roof. Very, very popular. Columns are symmetrical. The Greeks were very big on making sure things are equal. And you have the same number of columns in the front as in the back, same number of columns on the sides. We kind of do the same thing. We put columns on things, not because we need columns, because it looks cool and it reminds us of ancient Greece. You go down to Chicago, you go down Wacker Avenue, you look up at 77 West Wacker and you see something. Oh, there's columns up there. They're not holding anything up. Oh, there's that triangular shaped roof. The guy who made this building called it Paste on Parthenon, because he wants you, when you're walking through Chicago, to stop, look up and say, oh, that's the Parthenon, that's ancient Greece. He did it on purpose to link his building to the buildings that were built 2,500 years ago. Soldier Field is the same way. These columns serve no purpose except their decoration. They're symmetrical. They're taking in those Greek and Roman ideas of symmetry and balance and using the Doric columns as a means to do that. They didn't have to, but they did it because that's what we do. We link ourselves to the ancient Greek world. This is the Pantheon in Rome today. It's one of the oldest continually used buildings that dates to the Roman Empire. The front has the Greek columns with the triangular roof, but the Romans added something. They took that idea of the arch and they expanded it and created the first dome. Right? That's the original dome. You know, that was built in 125 CE. The original dome on the Pantheon. Now, this building so impressed our third president, Thomas Jefferson, that Thomas Jefferson built his own house. He put the Greek facade, just like the Pantheon right there. He put a dome on it. And because he was one of our greatest presidents, we built a memorial to him in Washington, D.C., which looks like that Roman building with the Greek front and the Roman dome with the columns going all around it. If you go inside, there's a statue of Jefferson, and he's standing there in contrapposto style. Now this is the aqueduct in Spain. We just saw this. And this is a really cool aqueduct. They have the arch. The arch is what the Romans loved. They're like, this is the coolest thing. You can repeat that arch over and over again. You get this aesthetically very Greek-like idea about symmetry and balance. And so these structures crisscrossed all throughout Europe, Southern Europe, for sometimes hundreds, thousands of miles. They didn't have to do it this way. But they chose the arch and the repetitive nature of the arch to do what the Greeks had done. And for the Romans, the arch represented something else. It represented power. So they started building arches for no purpose whatsoever than just to show how great they are. Roman emperors would plop up an arch in the middle of a street. This is the Arch of Constantine. And it was built by Roman Emperor Constantine. You've got to drive around it today. And it has scenes showing how great Constantine is, and three arches. The arches aren't holding anything up. They're just showing, hey, we made the arch, and we are cool, and so we are powerful, and here's my arch. And so people have done this in response. Napoleon did it. He built the Arc de Triomphe in Paris. He said, if the Romans have an arch to show how great they are, I'm going to have an arch. We built an arch for George Washington in New York City, in Washington Park. And there's Washington's arch, and there's Washington standing in contrapposto style. The arch is just to show power. The Romans use the arch to show how great they are. It's no coincidence that the St. Louis monument to the west was an arch. And the most recognizable arches in the world are the golden arches. There's the very first McDonald's in Des Plaines. McDonald's chose the arch, the same reason why the Romans chose the arch, to show power, to show, and in this case, I mean, that's the most recognizable arch in the world, because the golden arches are everywhere. It's not just an M, I mean, it's an arch to show power. So the arch becomes this symbol, and the arch can be seen in some of Rome's greatest buildings, like the Colosseum. The Colosseum's got arches. The Colosseum, of course, is a sports stadium. Right? The Romans were all about spectacle. And they would have these spectacles in these great buildings where they would have gladiator games and They would kill thousands of animals a year in blood sport, and people would watch. Some of those same buildings that the Romans used are used in southern France and in Spain today for bullfights. All right? It's the same thing. And we have taken this concept of the stadium that the Romans used, and we've taken the same ideas to build our stadiums across the country. It's no different. The same architectural techniques that went into building the Colosseum and other Roman stadiums are used in stadiums all across the world today in our country. So that's the legacy of this era. It's all around us. And looking at the art of the ancient Greek world, we can see that it's even in our government buildings. This is, of course, Congress. You've got columns all the way around, and you've got a dome. But you walk inside, and you know, a lot of people, when they look up in the dome and see this painting, they don't really realize what's going on. This is called the apotheosis of George Washington. There's George Washington. He is surrounded by people in togas. Those aren't Americans. Those are Roman gods. He is surrounded by Roman gods. Apotheosis means to become a god. This painting is saying that Washington is like the Roman gods. Our founding fathers wanted to create a concrete link from us in our early republic to ancient Greece and Rome, that we created this. That is the goddess of the United States. We created our own goddess because, you know, Athens had Athena, all the Greek city-states had gods or goddesses. We created our own. We gave her a shield with the red, white, and blue, and we called her Columbia. We even have a statue of her on the top of the Congress building. There she is, that's Columbia. She is dressed like Athena in a kind of Greek outfit. She's got a sword, she's got laurel leaves, but she's also wearing a Native American headdress, and she's looking out over Washington, D.C., because that's her district, the District of Columbia, this goddess. Now, does this mean that our founding fathers believed in this goddess? No, not at all, but it's symbolic. It's basically our founding fathers saying we want to be like ancient Greece. And so we're going to create a goddess too. And we're going to create a capital named after her, Washington, in the District of Columbia. Because that's the link that we have. And so anytime you see a guy on a horse, you're going to, you know, think about ancient Rome. And when we look at these statues, it should be pretty easy to tell what age they're in, because they have certain things that changed over the years. Like, if we were to look at this statue, this naked dude without arms, he's standing in contrapposto style. What age is he? He's Hellenic. Yep. We look at this guy in the military uniform. Contrapposto, that hasn't changed. All right, that's the continuity. And he's Roman. And then this woman who's in contrapposto, what is she? Hellenistic, because she's a sheep. You wouldn't have seen this in the ancient Greek world. Now we're going to see how much you remember. All right? We're going to do a little quiz. Okay, we're not going to do the quiz, though, on the sheet. We're going, you know, we've graduated to a new technology. You're going to need your iPads. Okay, this will take about 3 minutes or so, which will be plenty of time. I'm going to send it to your teacher, so your teacher can figure that out.